firing at the post Makkah Masjid.
So, with permission of this one.
Yeah, please.
And other conditions for the four incidents?
For the incident, the allegation was that a lot of Muslim youth were being targeted without reasoning. And they were all being put in jail without following law. That was the allegation. They wanted a fact-finding into the whole thing. So I was appointed as a one-man commission. I was also given the liberty. I was also given the liberty to take any assistance that I wanted. Therefore, I took a forensic expert with me. We went to the jail. I went there about 3 times and met with all of the people who were in the jail. And I submitted a report. See, firstly, I was not so concerned with whether they were guilty or not guilty. That was not my problem at all. My point of reference was as to whether these people who had been put in jail, you know, picked up, was it done in accordance with law? After all, when the police have a suspicion about somebody, they are entitled to arrest and investigate. What happened, unfortunately, in this case is that the police jumped the gun, and jumped the gun in a big way. They went about midnight knocks, kidnapping, closing their eyes and taking them away to some places. Their body showed that their private parts were affected. Some minor shocks were given. All this is non-acceptable to me, or non-acceptable to anybody who believes in the discipline of law. I submitted a report saying that there was a gross violation of all these procedural safeguards, both under the Code of Criminal Procedure and in the famous case of D.K. Bhashan. What happened after that was, these boys came up for trial. All of them, without exception, were acquitted. Now, in my report to the commission, I said 3 things, basically. Firstly, I said that the police had wronged. They had wronged the guarantees of a system governed by the rule of law. They had violated procedural guarantees that are assured to every citizen. The second thing I said is from the nature of the profile of the people picked up, it was quite obvious that they had targeted a group of people. It was quite obvious, and all of them belonged to a economic category. Most of them were lower middle class families and living on the brinks of poverty line, except one or two of them who were medical. One was a medical student, one was an MBA undergrad. But for them, I think all of them were marginally educated or uneducated, etc. I also faulted them, and I said that by just releasing them now, it's not going to help. You need to rehabilitate them. And we need to send a loud signal to the police that such a kind of a system is unacceptable in a system governed by a constitutional legal system. I believe that there was some rehabilitation done, some monies were given. I am recently told that they were even given some certificates of good conduct. Not that it matters at all, because after giving them the certificate of good conduct, after the present blast, again they are being targeted, again they are being arrested or called in for interrogation. So, the report did not completely fructify in the sense, I don't think any signal was sent to the police saying this is not acceptable, we will not do it any longer. None of the police officers who have traumatized the lives of these young boys have been punished in any manner, not even a symbolic punishment, not even a warning has been given to them. And interestingly, probably it's difficult for the government. I quite see how the government comes from, because it would not like to displease the police, and in these days of terrorism, probably they don't want to be on the wrong side of an investigating agency. But to me, a state breaking of the law is just about as bad as a citizen threatening terrorism. And to me, the rule of law is far more important as a on a balance than the lives of the people who live in a democracy. I think it was Ben Franklin who once said, "Those who give up a bit of their freedom for a bit of security deserve neither." And we've come to a time when all people need to shout out and say that a government that breaks laws every time is unacceptable. Now, it's not easy. I know it's going to be extremely difficult for the police to investigate a crime of such a large nature. But then they are to do this. Why are they investigating? Because law empowers them to investigate. Law gives them the power to arrest. Law gives them the power to examine, to investigate. Now, if you are bound by the law and you have been licensed by the law to do something, you will do only what the law asks you to do. Just because you're a police officer, it doesn't mean you're more concerned about the country than you or I are. All of us are equally concerned. That doesn't mean I can go and catch up a man and say you're a terrorist and beat him up, right? We live in a civilized society. And when the police breaks the law, it's an indication that we are not living in a very civilized society. The other great tragedy is, you know, we, unlike other neighboring countries, we claim to be, and we are, a secular country. Our secular credentials are not in doubt. Now, these kind of aberrations that happen on and off, when people suddenly come in and start saying, no, no, one community of people are terrorists, or another community of people are terrorists, so it's a very wrong global signal. Also, look at it in perspective today. Afterwards, all of them were acquitted. All of them were acquitted. And how do you rehabilitate a man who has spent 6 months in jail, who's been called a terrorist, who's been beaten up? How do you rehabilitate this man? What have you done to psychologically bring him back into mainstream? You've done nothing about it. Probably for some people, you've given some money, you've said they'll be rehabilitated. This mindset that I can do whatever I want to and then give you some bit of money and be happy and be done away with, not acceptable at all. And today the great tragedy is, I hear it from newspapers over the last 2-3 days, and some people from the media have been talking to me about this, that again the same boss set of people have been called up for interrogation. Question asked, is the police not entitled to interrogate? Of course the police is entitled to interrogate. But the manner in which, then when something of this kind happens, you suddenly rush to one set of people and say, we suspect you, please come and answer me. That is very, very, very dangerous. Far more dangerous to me than the problem of terrorism itself. Obviously, see, I'm told now, this also you'll have to verify with other people. The report was lying with the Minority Commission for a very long time. It didn't even go from the Minority Commission to the State Government for a while. Then there was a noise about it and all that. And then it did go, and then the State Government has acted on it. It has rehabilitated some people by giving them monetary benefits. It has certified, given them certificates of good conduct, which shows that there is some level of sensitivity to the whole thing. And, you know, one thing very positive about all this was yesterday or the day before yesterday, the police commissioner, Mr. Anurag Sharma, seems to have, when the media was talking to him, appears to have said, no, we will not go the same road that we did last time. So there seems to be a suggestive acceptance of the fact that what was wrong then will not be wrong again. So to that extent, see, understand, finally, civic society will make noise. That's their role in a democracy. And reports of this kind is just to, it's a kind of an insurance against a power-hungry system. But policemen have their own limitations. They are insensitive to a lot of constitutional nuances. And they are result-oriented. And when I say result-oriented, they're statistics and number-oriented. So they would like to show their bosses political or otherwise, these are the number of arrests we made, this is the kind of investigation we've done. So as a consequence of which, they are also geared by a physics of their own. And consequently, probably they were all bona fide in doing what they were. I'm not saying they wanted to do this. But I'm saying it's a mindset. It's a tragic mindset. It's an unacceptable mindset in the context of our constitution and our secular credentials. And therefore, it will have to stop sooner than later.
You have any reference to the media, trial and media?
Largely more irresponsible than it can afford to be. But then that's the role of the media. The media can shout as much as it can. I'd like a vibrant media to be there. So I have. I would like to believe that I'm very indifferent to a lot of things said in the media. How many people in the common citizenry are indifferent, I don't know, because it can sway emotions. But no, between over-enthusiastic media and a controlled media, I would any day prefer an over-enthusiastic media. Controlling the media by do's and don'ts, by an external agency, I'm very uncomfortable with. Today there is so The ground reality is that there is so much of competition. There is so much of competition in the media. I was just today reading about the number of media houses in Kerala. 17, 20 or whatever. So, and every media wants the eyeball on their screens. So they'll have to say something more dramatic. They'll have to create more interest. Now today when Prince falls into a well, you have a whole day story going on Prince in the well. This is the reality now. You don't wish it away. I don't go and tell a media house, please close shop because other media houses are finding you competitive. So given the kind of competition and given the kind of world we live in, I'm not surprised that they're doing what they're doing. Now it's not a question of whether the media is like that, whether the police is like that. I think the citizen is like that. See? And as the citizen who goes into the media, as the citizen who goes into the police, as the citizen who goes elsewhere into the system. So we all are willing to blame platforms within the system, forgetting that we are those who are contributing to these weak platforms. So to answer the question in a short manner, I would like to say even if the media is exaggerating, so be it. It's their job. Someday hopefully sanity will prevail. Someday they will begin to realize that they need to balance their commercial needs with social diktats.
So, what is the legal issue when some atrocities have been done by the police officers, and how they can treat it by legally?
Or the police or the citizen?
So the policemen. They are beaten and tortured.
Well, see, what happens is if there is an official finding on that. Courts do that. I think yesterday the Punjab High Court, Punjab and Haryana High Court, just about a few days ago, has ordered compensation against police officers for this kind of action in Punjab against alleged Sikh militants, and have said that these amounts must be recovered from the income and salaries of the police officers. Now, this is a very interesting signal. The Supreme Court and even the Andhra Pradesh High Court had held that if a police officer commits an illegal act in the course of his duty, then the vicarious liability shifts on the state and the state is bound to compensate. May not be in the case of under trial prisoner or in the case of terrorist prisoner. For me, they don't make a difference. To me, all of them are under trials till they are convicted. And once they are convicted, they follow the same format of punishment as anybody else does. And they get the same punishment that the IPC gives them or the law under which their tribe gives them. Merely because you are a terrorist or merely because you are a rapist, you don't get a more crude treatment from the state. It doesn't happen. That's not what the law of this country says. Therefore, the answer is that the police officer must be proceeded with in accordance with law, his it's a symbiotic relationship in crime, the police and the politician. And it would be very, very, very naive and foolhardy to believe that the police in this country will be acted upon. See how much had to be done before police were investigated in Gujarat. It hasn't happened. It was so blatant, it was so obvious. Yet you needed the intervention by the Supreme Court to come in. How much happened after Rajan in Kerala? It took a whole historic movement to happen in Kerala before the police were touched after Rajan was killed in Rajan. So, the history of Indian constitutionalism is blotted by indulgence against the police. We are very police friendly people and the police are very anti people. And this admix goes on, and I am very cynical. I really don't believe that we will have governments that will really stick their neck out and count their head on and say, these are the police officers who make the mistakes, let them pay. Won't happen.
One more thing is like, when the committee was formed, there was a huge pressure from the civil society also, fact-finding and public hearing on the present, on that issue. And then the government also responded with the committee's report. So that there is a huge lot of many, many years, in the sense, like Verma committee report, whichever government, what it does, it initiates a committee report. And at last, just to convince the masses for delaying it, even the Telangana committee report or like that, whatsoever, everything like that.
Yeah.
So do you think like that also winding up, even Usha Mehra committee report?
See,
also?
See, committee reports come in because they look for non-institutional viewpoints. That's the logical reason at looking at it. Because if it has to go through a court of law, then it's going to take a few hundred years. We God knows what will happen with it. So to a certain extent, these commissions are useful. Having said that, sometimes they become the area for the government to escape. Now, if you catch up with this lawyer called Mr. Majid, who appeared at length before the Bhaskar Rao Commission, he has telltale signs. He says what the commission did is wholly unacceptable. Now, there are commissions and commissions. We've had commissions which dilute the whole problem, but that's the kind of men you choose. And I know that certain sections of the media were against my appointment at the initial stage. They said, why are you appointing a man who appeared against the Muslims in a reservations case? I had appeared, I had opposed a reservation for Muslims as a lawyer. And I had appeared in that case and I told certain media in the vernacular language.
In Telugu.
In Urdu.
Urdu,
I carried a stinking article saying as if the whole of Hyderabad didn't have one advocate, they had to pick me up. After the report came, I suddenly became the nice guy, the good boy and all that. So see, this happens. As long as you're honest about it, and there lies India's tragedy. I think we don't have too many of them any longer. People who are willing to stick their necks out, people who are willing to be honest, people who are not willing to get curry favors from the government, they are endangered species.
Sir, of course, every common citizen, this is about the media, sir. Every common citizen needs a vibrant media to expose the government, or that's a pressure. That's
true,
a fourth
true.
Pillar in our constitutional side, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah,
so that what I was thinking is, but however, they cannot show hatred at one particular, for example,
they,
without...
What they're saying, they're not saying...
It's actually, the thing is, when the judiciary, for example, the judiciary, when a matter isn't a judicial thing, the media should restrain from holding it. Even the beginning when you were saying that the present issue which the media targets at one particular thing, it gives an internationally very bad signal also it gives. So in that context, how do you see? Do you think they are going over
Oh, they are. They are.
Reacting.
There's no doubt about it. We're all going overboard. Everybody is going overboard. Who is not going overboard? Having said that, you know, this whole theory about Voltaire and Rousseau.
Yeah.
Voltaire said, "I'll till my death, I'll fight Rousseau's thought, but I'll fight his right to be wrong." Yeah. Now, democracy is about your right to be wrong. I've said this before. I'm saying this again. So the look at the alternative. Look at the alternative. The alternative is more dangerous. Somebody begins to control the media and says, you must say only this much, you can't do this, you can't do this. Unless it is self-imposed.
Yeah.
If it's self-imposed, good, we are talking of an ideal situation. That's not going to happen. Because what will happen is this. There's one media house talking loud, talking very dramatic stuff, talking things that, you know, there's death at your doorstep. And you are here, you are standing up and saying, here's the news, 15 people died, this has happened. Now these two will not gel. Everybody is going to get their TRPs with the other news media. So your news media, management is going to say, what are you doing? Why are you so behind? And your pay packet, your incentives are all based on how many TRPs you get. So obviously you want to be a little more dramatic. So everybody is self-oriented. We begin to take our decisions based on what my immediate requirement is.
Actually, when you say it is over-enthusiastic media, it means they are independent. Can I understand? Or they are trying to be independent?
The media is independent. There is no doubt about that.
Then,
but independence does not mean honest. In the sense, every media house has its own political lineage. It has a commitment to a political party, to a political group, to a political ideology, maybe in Kerala. Now, therefore, what happens is, I would like to perpetuate that. See, typically, that's human. Today, when I sit down and look at any issue, I probably instinctively look at it from the angle of a human right activist, from civil liberties activist. Now, this is because, to me, that is a sensitive issue. Now, take somebody who's sensitive to commerce. Probably he will look at the whole thing from an angle of commerce. Tomorrow probably you, Economic Times or some economic-based television channel would probably say, let us look at the financial losses that happened because of the bond loss. They look at it a complete finance angle or an economic angle. So it all depends, even with an independent media, it depends on how and who mans it. What is their, see, after all of them have a base, isn't it? That's why you're a media house. It's not an easy thing to become a media house in this country. Calls for big money, calls for good system support. Now, we know international media, one is pro-Congress, we know one is anti-Congress. We know that these media houses, the common man may not know it, but at least the intelligentsia knows the difference and knows when Daily talks about Nadia tapes, how seriously to take it, or when another media talks about Gadkari, how seriously to take it. So, that's where we are.
So, last one more.